In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
It was 4 years ago, in November 2016, that Pastor David Kang died. Evelyn and I got into our car and drove down to Georgia to his funeral. And Pastor David Kang was one of the most godly ministers that we had anywhere in the Adventist Church, anywhere in the world. He was a Korean from South Korea. My brother, by the way, my late brother Marshall, was a good friend of his. My brother and Pastor Kang flew to Korea for revival meetings in 1989. Like I said, those of you that have attended our camp meetings in past years, you know, we used to invite Pastor Kang to our camp meetings, and everybody enjoyed his messages because they were so spiritual. And he was a spiritual person, and he risked his life over and over again to go to China. And he had hundreds of people in China that he was working with that were distributing books, Bibles, literature, to the people. He went to China himself, and he conducted seminars with non-Adventist preachers and explained to them about the sanctuary and what it meant to today. This is my own humble opinion. I believe that Pastor David Kang has done more than any other one person in Adventism to get the gospel and three angels' messages to China. Why does God, and Pastor Kang was not an old man. He was born in 1948. You know, he wasn't an old man in 2016 when he died. And people ask the question, I don't know how many times people ask the question, why does God allow somebody that is so godly and that is doing such a wonderful work to spread the three angels' messages to die? And actually, Pastor David Kang, and I told the people this at the funeral, I told them, I said, I believe you're going to find out someday that Pastor David Kang died a martyr. And actually, there have been many martyrs among the messengers that God has sent to his remnant people that we don't know. People think that they had an accident. He said, I want to shout with all my heart that Jesus is coming soon. Jesus will soon come again. I want to show with my life, that he is coming soon. We must keep our focus on the second coming of Jesus Christ. The important thing is not how much we know the truth, but how much we are transformed by the truth. The truth that cannot transform the life is not genuine. The latter rain of the Holy Spirit is the only way to finish the propagation of the gospel. Therefore, the objective of our ministry must be to prepare the people to receive the latter rain. To be perfect means to have the love of God within. He who truly loves God will obey his word. Act by faith, not by the things which are seen. God's honor depends upon his people. We must live for his glory. If we must choose between justice and mercy, we should choose mercy. If we have the truth and God is with us, there is nothing to fear. I thought that would be an encouragement to you to have those statements that Pastor Kang used to declare to his fellow workers. And those are principles that will be, I think, helpful to us if we remember them. Before we begin our study this morning, let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we're going to study. Father in heaven, we thank you for the wonderful and exciting hope that we have in the soon coming of Jesus. And we earnestly pray that you will teach us as we study this morning what we are to do, how we are to prepare for that event. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I have given my remarks this morning three different titles, and I don't know which one is the best one or the good one. I'll tell you what the three ways that I titled it. The first title I gave to it is The Future of Our Cities. The second title I gave to it is Getting Ready for What is Soon to Happen in Our Cities. The third title I gave to it, I don't know which one of these is the best. The third title I gave to it is Our Duty in Light of the Fact About What is Coming on the Cities. There are some cities, and this has always been true, there are some cities that are more favored than other cities. Some people don't like that. They want everything to be equal, but everything's not equal in this world. This was true anciently, this is true today. There are some cities that have been especially favored by the God of heaven. Now let me ask you a simple question. You'll know the answer to this. In the ancient world, what city was the most favored of all cities in the world? What city was the most favored? I want to hear it.
Jerusalem.
Thank you. Jerusalem. Jerusalem was the most favored city of the ancient world. Why was it the most favored city? Well, there are a number of reasons. Let me read a few of them to you from the pen of Ellen White. This is about Jerusalem. He writes, "For ages, Judah had been the repository of sacred truths. Here, the knowledge of Jehovah had been cherished and preserved when God had not been acknowledged among the nations and his worship was lost in the earth. The streets of Jerusalem had been trodden by angel feet." Who walked the streets of Jerusalem? Angels. She says, "Its very soil had been sacred to God." And that's quite a statement. The very soil, the very ground of Jerusalem was sacred to God. He says, "From its temple, prayer and praise had ascended to God. From its altar, the bleeding sacrifice had testified to human guilt, pointing to the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world. The Lord had sent them messages of warning and reproof, of consolation and promise by his prophets, rising up early and sending them, but they had beaten one and stoned another, and it could not be that a prophet should perish outside of Jerusalem. Finally, God had sent his Son." God did not send his Son to Rome or to Damascus, to Babylon, to Alexandria, to Athens. God sent his Son to Jerusalem. It was the most, by far, the most favored city in the world. Why do I emphasize this so much? Listen, when God gives to us greater blessings, that involves greater responsibility. Does that make sense? Think it through. Is it fair for God to say, since you have received more blessings, you are more accountable, you are more responsible than other cities? Is that fair to say? Yes, it is. So Jerusalem was the most favored city in the world. But we read in our scripture reading, they had rejected the messages of the prophets. They had killed some, stoned some, And when Jesus, when our scripture reading today, that took place on what is called Palm Sunday, and Jesus was crucified that Friday. Jesus knew what was going to happen. He knew that in a few days that the Jewish nation was going to take him and they were going to put him to an ignominious death. They were going to reject his claim that he was the Son of God, reject his claim to divinity, reject his claim that he was the only one that could save them. And this is astonishing when you try to think it through in your mind. The very thing that brought hope of forgiveness and eternal life to the whole world, that very thing brought the doom of the Jewish nation. Isn't that true? Is the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross the only thing that can bring any hope to you or me, that our sins can be forgiven, that we can have eternal life? Is that the only thing? That's the only thing. There is no forgiveness of sin without the blood of Jesus Christ. Doesn't matter what religion you are. Your sins can't be forgiven unless the blood of Jesus Christ is applied to them. The very thing that makes forgiveness of sins possible for the whole world, that very thing guaranteed the doom of the Jewish nation. Here's how Ellen White describes it. He says, his prophetic eye, that's Christ, read the history of the past and the woe and the guilt of the future, and his heart was breaking with agony because the people of God knew not the time of their visitation. Hell moved by a power from beneath, that the guilty inhabitants of Jerusalem might carry out the will of the Prince of Darkness. Stirred with enmity, they would yield themselves to the control of the malignant foe and make the Prince of Life their victim. Clouds of wrath were gathering over the doomed city. That blood by which a guilty world might be saved, by which the Jewish nation might be saved and purified, which was paid a ransom for the sins of the world, was to them the final guilt in the cup of their iniquity. Jesus knew that his chosen people were to put him, the Prince of Life and Glory, to an ignominious death. He knew what was to be their doom. So, Jerusalem was the most favored city. Wonder what they did that week. It became the most cursed city in the world. It's an irony, isn't it? That the most favored city could become the most cursed city in the world. But it happened. Ellen White writes about this again in the book Desire of Ages, page 587 and 588. Let me read a few sentences. He says, the fetters which the nation had for centuries been forging, the people of Christ's day were fastening upon themselves. In every age, there is given to men their day of light and privilege, a probationary time in which they may become reconciled to God. But there is a limit to this grace. Mercy may plead for years and be slighted and rejected, but there comes a time when mercy makes her last plea. Did you get that? There comes a time when mercy knocks for the last time. And if you don't respond at the last call, then there is never an invitation of mercy to you again. As the heart becomes so hardened that it ceases to respond to the Spirit of God, then the sweet winning voice entreats the sinner no longer, and reproofs and warnings cease. I've met people that tell me that they don't like to read the spirit of prophecy because they feel rebuked. When I hear that, I say, Lord, I want every rebuke. I want every reproof that you have for me. I want it. The fact that I'm being reproved and rebuked shows that I haven't committed the unpardonable sin. He says the reproofs and warnings ceased. That day had come to Jerusalem. Jesus wept in anguish over the doomed city, but he could not deliver her. He had exhausted every resource. In rejecting the warnings of God's Spirit, Israel had rejected the only means of help. And then she makes this interesting statement. Jerusalem, the Jewish nation, was a symbol. Symbol of what? Notice what she says. The Jewish nation was a symbol of the people of all ages who scorned the pleadings of infinite love. It's a symbol of what? People of all ages who scorn the pleadings of infinite love. Oh, my dear friend, please don't ever think that probation is just going to go on and on and on. It's not. The day when you and I can receive mercy and forgiveness of sins, that time is going to end. He says, in this generation, there are many who are treading on the same ground as were the unbelieving Jews. They have witnessed the manifestation of the power of God. The Holy Spirit has spoken to their hearts, but they cling to their unbelief and resistance. God sends them warnings and reproof, but they are not willing to confess their errors. They reject his message and his messenger. The very means he uses for their recovery becomes to them a stone of stumbling. Today, the servant of Christ, the reprover of sin, meets with scorn and rebuffs. Bible truth, the religion of Christ, struggles against a strong current of moral impurity. Prejudice is even stronger in the hearts of men now than in Christ's day. By the way, that was written before 1900. The truth of God's word does not harmonize with men's practices and their natural inclination, and thousands reject its light. Christ overlooked the world and all ages from the height of Olivet, and his words are applicable to every soul who slights the pleadings of divine mercy. Are there places today that have been most favored of God, that have been more favored of God? Are there cities today that have been more favored of God than other cities? Yes, there are. And I want to show you something interesting from the book of Jeremiah. This actually has impressed my mind for many decades. If you turn in your Bible to Jeremiah 25, Jeremiah 25, here's a prophecy about what is going to happen. We'll read the end first, and then we'll read what leads up to it. Jeremiah 25, verses 32 and 33. Thus says the Lord of hosts, behold, disaster shall go forth from nation to nation, and a great whirlwind shall be raised up from the farthest parts of the earth. And at that day, the slain of the Lord shall be from one end of the earth even to the other end of the earth. They shall not be lamented, or gathered, or buried. They shall become refuse on the ground. Okay, this is a prophecy about the end of our world as we know it. This is what is going to happen when Jesus comes the second time, and this same prophecy is repeated again in the last part of Revelation 19. But I want you to see in the book of Jeremiah what leads up. Now, this is the final thing. There won't be a single wicked person, unsaved person left alive on the earth. That's what he says. There won't be a single one. There'll be refuse on the ground. But what leads up to this? Well, let's read it. Go back to verse 15. For thus says the Lord God of Israel to me, take this wine cup of fury from my hand and cause all the nations to whom I send you to drink it. So Jeremiah is told, you take this wine cup of fury from my hand and you cause all the nations to drink from this. Verse 16, and they will drink and stagger and go mad because of the sword that I will send among them. Verse 17, then I took the cup from the Lord's hand and made all the nations drink to whom the Lord had sent me. Who is the first nation mentions that drinks the cup of fury from the Lord? Who's the next first nation mentioned? Verse 18. Who is it? It's Jerusalem. Jerusalem is the first nation mentions that is going to drink the cup of fury from the Lord's hand in the time of His judgment. It's Jerusalem. I hope you know who Jerusalem represents. Let's go down and read verses 28 and 29. And it shall be, if they refuse to take the cup from your hand to drink, then you shall say to them, thus says the Lord of hosts, you shall certainly drink. For behold, I began to bring calamity on the city which is called by my name, and should you be utterly unpunished, you shall not be unpunished. For I will call for a sword on all the inhabitants of the earth, says the Lord of hosts. Notice carefully, now again, verse 18 and verses 28 and 29. When the cup of fury from the Lord's hand is given to the nations of this world to drink, who drinks it first? Jerusalem. Jerusalem drinks first. Now, I want to study with you about what is going to happen to the cities of our world. I'm going to read to you some statements from the Spirit of Prophecy about what is going to happen to the cities. This one is Letter 278, written in 1906, found in several different places. I'm reading actually from the book Evangelism, page 29. He says, last Friday morning, just before I awoke, a very impressive scene was presented before me. I seemed to awake from sleep, but was not in my home. From the windows I could behold a terrible conflagration. Great balls of fire were falling upon houses, and from these balls fiery arrows were flying in every direction. It was impossible to check the fires that were kindled, and many places were being destroyed. The terror of the people was indescribable. After a time, I awoke and found myself at home. The time is near. This is written in 1910. The time is near when large cities will be swept away, and all should be warned of these coming judgments. Oh, let me ask you something. If the large cities are going to be swept away and they should be warned of these coming judgments, who do you think should warn them? Got to be somebody that knows it's coming. Well, who knows it's coming? The only people that know it's coming are the people that have studied prophecy, the people that have the spirit of prophecy. S- Soon grievous troubles will... This is written in 19:4. Soon grievous troubles will arise among the nations, trouble that will not cease until Jesus comes. As never before, we need to press together, serving Him who has prepared His throne in the heavens and whose kingdom ruleth over all. God has not forsaken His people. And our strength lies in not forsaking Him. The judgments of God are in the land. The wars and rumors of wars, the destruction by fire and flood, say clearly that the time of trouble, which is to increase until the end, is very near at hand. We have no time to lose. The world is stirred with a spirit of war. The prophecies of the 11th of Daniel have almost reached the final fulfillment. You understand what that means? The prophecies of Daniel 11 have almost reached their final fulfillment. It says in the end of Daniel 11 concerning the king of the north, he will come to his end. He's going to go out to destroy many, but he will come to his end and nobody will help him. And in that time, Michael will stand up. The Savior's prophecy concerning the visitation of judgments upon Jerusalem. We just read that in our scripture today in Luke 19. The Savior's prophecy concerning the visitation of judgments upon Jerusalem is to have another fulfillment, of which that terrible desolation was but a faint shadow. Have you read the first chapter of Great Controversy lately? Do you understand what happened to Jerusalem in 70 AD? He says, what happened there is a faint shadow. Faint shadow of what? It's a faint shadow of what's going to happen all over the world, the cities all over the world. He says, the Savior's prophecy concerning the visitation of God's judgments upon Jerusalem is to have another fulfillment, of which that terrible desolation was but a faint shadow. In the fate of the chosen city, we may behold the doom of a world that has rejected God's mercy and trampled upon His law. Let me ask you this question. What we're talking about, does it apply to Wichita, Kansas? Is Wichita, Kansas a city? It is. Now, maybe you're going to think I'm selfish when I tell you this. Ellen White says that the bigger the city, the more the trouble is going to be, and I've taken comfort for many years in the fact that Wichita is not as big as Oklahoma City or Tulsa or Dallas or Fort Worth or St. Louis or Kansas City or a whole bunch of other cities, but it's still a city. What is going to happen to the cities? Let me read to you this statement. The end is near. And every city, would that include Wichita? Every city is to be turned upside down every way. There will be confusion in every city. You understand from this what's coming? You understand what's going to happen to the world? You know, it used to be, we're living in the end times, it used to be that when something like this happened, people would say, well, I'm getting out of here. And so people have fled. If you like to study history, you have seen this happen over and over and over again. People say, well, it's not safe to live here anymore, so we'll go over there. So they flee to somewhere else. That is how there came to be a place called the United States of America. People fled from all over the world where there was oppression, where there was trouble, where there was a persecution, where there was instability, where there was a high crime rate. They fled from all over the world to this land. Because this land was a land that offered religious liberty and civil liberty. And because of that, this land became the greatest nation in the earth. It became the most privileged nation in the earth. This nation has been more privileged of God than any other nation in the world. Jerusalem is more privileged than any other city of the world. Remember, if you're more privileged, you have more what? You have more responsibility. You have more accountability. He says, the end is near, and every city is to be turned upside down every way. There will be confusion in every city. Everything that can be shaken is to be shaken. And we do not know what will come next. The judgments will be according to the wickedness of the people and the light of truth that they have had. Remember what we read in the Tsar of Ages? In every age, there's a time of mercy, a time when there's an invitation for salvation, a time of probation, a time of mercy. But if the mercy is rejected, if the message of God is rejected, and the people become more and more wicked, eventually, the Lord says, okay, the mercy will stop and the judgment will begin. God is withdrawing His Spirit from the wicked cities, which have become as the cities of the antediluvian world and as Sodom and Gomorrah. Costly mansions, marvels of architectural skill, will be destroyed without a moment's notice. When the Lord sees that the owners have passed the boundaries of forgiveness, the destruction by fire of the stately buildings supposed to be fireproof is an illustration of how in a short time earth's architecture will lie in ruin. Men will continue to erect expensive buildings costing millions of money. Special attention will be called to their architectural beauty and the firmness and solidity with which they are constructed. But the Lord has instructed me that despite the unusual firmness and expensive display, these buildings will share the fate of the temple in Jerusalem. What happened to the temple in Jerusalem? It was so totally destroyed, Jesus said, there won't be one stone left on top of another one. By the way, the temple in Jerusalem was built with architectural skill that we don't even understand today. Because the marble, the white marble stone, it looked like one solid piece of marble from the outside. And those marble stones were cut and they fit so tightly together. Historians have said you could not stick a knife blade between the joints. The joint was tight. I don't know anywhere in the world that we have that kind of architectural skill or building skill, engineering skill today. There was no mortar. There was a perfect fit so that they were tight, like a jigsaw puzzle. They fit together. The disciples could not understand how that could ever be destroyed until the end of the world unless the Lord destroyed it. Jesus said, there won't even be one stone left upon another. You know how that happened? When the temple was destroyed, there was lots and lots of gold in there. And when the temple was destroyed by fire, it was so hot that it melted the gold, and the gold ran down, and the Romans wanted that gold. And to get the gold, they tore the stones completely apart so that they could get the gold. There wasn't one stone left on another, just like Jesus said it would be. Well, are there cities today that have been specially favored? Yes, there are cities today that have been specially favored. I want to read to you from some statements about a city in the United States that has been an especially favored city by the God of heaven. This is not just any city. This is a city that has been especially favored, received the special favors of God more than other cities. I want to read to you a few statements from the pen of Ellen White about this city. He says, Nashville has been presented to me as the most favorable center from which to do a general work for all classes in the southern state. Where is the most favorable center for our work for all of the southern United States? Nashville. She says, there is no city in the South better suited than Nashville for the carrying forward of the publishing work. She instructed our people, you need to establish a publishing house in Nashville. That was why we had for many years the Southern Publishing Association. She wrote this, as a people, we should take a special interest in the work at Nashville. At the present time, this city is a point of great importance in the southern field. Our brethren selected Nashville as a center for work in the South because the Lord in His wisdom directed them there. Why did it become a center for our work? Because God directed His people to that city. Nashville had special advantages. Let me read you something about Nashville. This is from the Pen of Ellen White, too. There is not in Nashville the bitter opposition to the work for the uplifting of the downtrodden color race that exists in many other cities of the South. Much work is being done there to uplift the colored people, and the sentiment in favor of these efforts will be a security to our people in their work. Nashville had a more Christian spirit than any of the other large cities in the South. They actually provided colleges and hospitals, and Adventists built a sanitarium especially for the African-American people in Nashville. Now, let me ask you this question. If Nashville is one of the most favored cities in the United States and has been a Christian center for many, many decades, and it was a place where, you know where Madison College and Sanitarium were located? By the direct direction of the Lord of Heaven? They were located, Madison Hospital and Sanitarium. My parents lived there. As a boy, I went to school there. My father was a credit manager at that sanitarium. That place, the sanitarium, the college, the food industry, the farm, everything, that was located 9 miles from Nashville. It was located where they had easy access to help the people in Nashville. By the way, because Madison was located 9 miles from Nashville, did the people of Nashville have more spiritual opportunities than the people of almost any other city in the United States? They did. They had greater spiritual privileges and opportunities than the people of almost any other city in the United States. Now, remember what we were talking about Jerusalem. Jerusalem was the most favored city in the world. But if you're the most favored city in the world, do you have more responsibility? Will the judgments come to you first if you reject what the Lord has instructed you? Yes, they will. I want to read to you what is going to happen to Nashville. Now, what is going to happen to Nashville is not going to just happen to Nashville. It's going to happen to every other city in the world. We already read that. But many Bible students who studied these prophecies recently have come to the conclusion that when God judges the cities of this world, by the way, when God sends judgments on the cities of the world, what nation do you think the judgment's going to fall on first? It's going to fall on the nations that has received the greatest privileges of God. That's where they'll fall first. And in that nation, what city will be first? Well, it'll be a city that has had the greatest privileges. And my dear friends, Nashville has been one of the most privileged cities of the United States. We get many, many Christian materials from Nashville even today. In Steps to Life, we order them from Nashville. Nelson Bible Publishers are located, headquartered in Nashville. I want to read to you what's going to happen. This is a vision that Ellen White had on July 2, 1904. Here's what she writes. Last night, a scene was presented before me. It seemed that an immense ball of fire came down upon the world and crushed large houses. From place to place rose the cry that the Lord has come, the Lord has come. Many were unprepared to meet him, but a few were saying, praise the Lord. Why are you praising the Lord? Inquired those upon whom was coming the sudden destruction. Because we now see what we have been looking for. If you believe that these things were coming, why did you not tell us? Was the terrible response. By the way, do we have some obligation to these cities? We did not know about these things. Why did you leave us in ignorance? Again and again you have seen us. Now we're lost. I heard some say, we knew that the judgments of God were coming, but we did not know they would come so soon. Others said, you knew? Why then did you not tell us? We did not know. On every side I heard such words spoken. By the way, some people have asked us, why do you spend over $50,000 a year, way over $50,000 a year, to be on television? A lot of people don't even listen. When this time comes and this kind of thing happens, I don't want people to come to me and say, how come you didn't tell us? I want to be able to say, we tried to tell you. August 14, 1904. While I was in Nashville, a scene was opened before me. A great ball of fire seemed to fall from heaven, and from it went forth flashes of light. When these flashes of light would strike a building, the building would burn like tinder. That's like kindling. And then I heard someone say, I knew that this was coming. These are the judgments of God that I knew were coming. You knew, said another, you were my neighbor. Why did you not tell me that these things were coming? Why did you not warn? By the way, do you want somebody to say that to you? One of the things that I'll never forget as long as I have my reason. Some of you know that my family moved all over the world. My family, when I was growing up, lived all over the country and in foreign countries. But one thing I'll never forget as long as I live and have my reason. Anywhere we lived, whether it was Colorado, Idaho, Washington, Tennessee, Kansas, Illinois, wherever it was, we lived in all those places, Texas. Anywhere we lived, my father went to all the people that lived around us. Everybody that lived around us got literature from my father. And it wasn't literature about the weather. January 21, 1905. Listen to this carefully. When I was in Nashville, I was speaking to the people, and in the night season, there was an immense ball of fire that came right from heaven and settled in Nashville. Now, you can't misunderstand what she's talking about. This is not the Russians. This is not the Chinese. She says that an immense ball of fire came from where? It came from heaven. Those people aren't in heaven, and they can't send something from heaven. This is the divine judgment. A ball of fire came down, and it came and settled where? In Nashville. Now notice what happens. There were flames going out like arrows from that ball of fire. Houses were being consumed. Some of our people were standing there. They said, "It is just as we expected. We expected this." Now, when she says some of our people, who would that be? That'd be the Seventh-day Adventists. And they say, "Well, this is what we expected would happen." Now, notice what happens next. Others were wringing their hands in agony and crying unto God for mercy. "You knew it," said they. "You knew that this was coming and never said a word to warn us." They seemed as though they would almost tear them to pieces to think they had never told them or given them any warning at all. You want that to happen to you? You want the people feeling, being so angry, they feel like they can tear you to pieces because now they're getting destroyed and they're lost and you didn't tell them? Here's one last one. Read. There was a scene presented to me. It was the night before the Sabbath. And this is July 5, 1904. Friday night. By the way, if you read the Ellen White Mindings, you'll notice many plans. She talks about this vision that she received Friday night. It's this vision about the ball of fire falling on Nashville. It was the night before the Sabbath. This is when that scene was presented. That's the ball of fire that I just read to you, falling on Nashville. I looked out of the window, and there was an immense ball of fire that had come from heaven, and it fell where they were casting buildings with pillars. Especially the pillars were presented to me, and it seemed that ball came right to the building and crushed it. The ball of fire came down from heaven, it settled in Nashville, and it came to a building that had pillars, and it crushed that building. Now you can look at YouTube and find videos where it talks about this. Adventists will put this on YouTube. I'll just tell you real quickly. When you look at the context of everything that was said, what is the building that she's talking about that had all these pillars? And the ball of fire from heaven came and crushed that building. That building is located 5 miles from downtown Nashville. It was built in about 1897 for a special exhibition. It is supposedly almost an exact replica of the Greek Parthenon. That's what it's called, Parthenon. Probably because of that building that Nashville is sometimes called the Athens of the South. And inside that building, there, I'm told, there is the largest image, the largest idol that can be found anywhere in the United States. And the name of that idol is the name of a Greek god, which is said to be the protector of cities. Now, let me ask you something. What does the God of heaven think about people practicing idolatry and calling their idols a protector of cities when they have been the most favored city in the southern United States? What does God think about that? Well, this vision tells you what God thinks about it. It says, "It seemed that ball came right to the building and crushed it, and they saw that it was branching out and enlarging, and they began to cry and mourn and wring their hands. And I thought some of our people stood by there saying, 'Well, it is just what we have been expecting. It is just what we have been talking about. It is just what we have been talking about.' 'You knew it?' said the people. 'You knew it and never told us about it?' I thought there was such an agony in their face, such an agony in their appearance." What should we title these remarks? Is it just the future of the cities? Or is it, what obligation do we have to warn the cities? It's coming, friends. And it will come suddenly. You know, I read you the statement. She says, these grand buildings will be destroyed without a moment's notice. When I was a boy, They used to have fire drills to prepare us for intercontinental ballistic attack from Russia. You remember those days, some of you? And they used to tell us, if this happens, you might only have 30 minutes to get in your bomb shelter. And people were building bomb shelters in their backyard and putting in bomb shelters all over the United States. You can still get them if you want them. But then you'd have 30 minutes warning. She says, without a moment's warning. The only way to be ready is to know beforehand, because when it happens, there will be no time to get ready. When you study the past, you find out that that's always the way it's been. God sends a warning. If I'm willing to listen, I can be saved. I can escape. Jesus sent a warning about Jerusalem. The people that listened to his warning, did they escape the destruction when Jerusalem was destroyed? God sent a warning through Noah. The people that would listen were saved. But if you didn't listen, all of a sudden, bang, too late. Door was shut. God sent a message of warning to inhabitants of Sodom, and they wouldn't listen. They insulted the messengers. They wouldn't listen. Well, the next day, that was the last day for them. My dear friends, we are rapidly approaching the end of the world. Do you believe that? And the day is coming soon when the judgments of God are going to fall first on one city and then on another city. I just read you the statements. Before it's over, every city in the world will be turned upside down. There'll be confusion of every kind. We have an obligation to these cities because God still has a few people. Not many in proportion to the whole population, but God has a few people in all these cities. And our job is to say, Lord, help us to reach those people. And the only way we can reach them is to warn the whole city, and then whoever will listen. When the judgments come on Nashville, on Wichita, on all these other cities, I want to know that we've done everything we can to warn these cities. How about you? Do you think it'd be appropriate to pray about this before we sing our closing song? Let's kneel and pray together. Father in heaven, we know from prophecy that we are rapidly approaching a time when divine judgments are going to fall on the cities. And it is our job that you have given to us to warn them so that anybody that's willing to listen can escape the destruction that is coming. Lord, we need wisdom from on high. We need fortitude. We need good judgment. But we need to get the work done, and we earnestly pray that your Holy Spirit will teach us and inspire each one of us. What should we be doing in our sphere of influence to get the warning out to the cities of the world? Be our teacher and enable us, we pray, to effectively communicate not only a warning of the destruction of coming, but the offer of mercy if a person is willing to listen before it's too late. We pray this in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way.